So we have, we'll go through the step 5. We have finished 4 steps in terms of the global supply chain formation. So let us look at the feasible configurations. What we did was, after mapping the supply chain, we looked at the supply chain strategy, what are the kinds of innovations that are possible, and we looked at what are all the supply chain risks that they face, and so we are now ready to look at what are the feasible supply chain configurations for implementation. In other words, we have done our homework in terms of the various, for our vertical, for our company, what are the kinds of suppliers we need, who are the logistics providers, which countries are we in. And we also have information on the suppliers, financial, this one, which resources they have, which countries they are in, what are their governments, what are the delivery mechanisms, and so on. So once we have this kind of information that's possible, then we could now use this to identify what are the feasible supply chain configurations. So for the product of your company, whether it is knowledge, product, solutions, or value chains, identify the partners, companies, and countries for goods, information, and financial flows, and also the risks of partnering. You should identify the suppliers, you should identify the logistics providers, you should identify the suppliers of information, and also the financial, the banks, and others, and so on. Use the ecosystem information of partners, of your partners, while addressing the risk. In other words, you should do the so-called multi-tier risk management. Multi-tier risk management is, you should not only know about your suppliers, but their suppliers, and go up to the mines. And this could be a failure of the government, or a bank, or an earthquake, and so on. So there could be any kind of problems that can occur. So you should use the ecosystem information on this. Map the supply chain processes, including methods of collaboration, and also for ensuring partner loyalty. It's very important when you are outsourcing that the partner loyalty should be ensured. It's not only expected, but it should ensure that the partner loyalty. How do you do it? Besides joint ventures, or you have common conferences, joint conferences with them. You do whatever. So whatever you do, then it should be ensured. Partly, one has to be highly careful about this. Map your supply chain for each customer order. Have mitigation strategies for operational possible attacks, failures, and so on. And how do you mitigate risk? I mean, there are several ways in which in this AMR research gives you this. So we insource sensitive components and processes to protect IP. So in other words, you don't outsource very sensitive critical components and so on. That is what 41% of the people say. And we chose where to outsource based on the strength of IP protection laws. And we identify our IT IP before embarking on outsourcing relationship. We establish jointly developed protection requirements with contract manufacturers and design manufacturers. In-state exclusivity requirements to reduce the risk of outsourcing. Dual sourcing to avoid sharing too much of IP with single sourcer. So basically, you have several methods of mitigating IP risk. It's from dual sourcing to various kinds of protection and so on. So basically, how to mitigate IP risk, and the most successful methods are given here in this. So in other words, nothing is easy. You cannot avoid any risk, but there are several ways in which you can try to mitigate and be prepared to do it. So, and then also you should do the map the enablers and the supply chain performance. What are they given this? I mean, here are some standard enablers for supply chain, logistics, IT, trade policies, and so on. But for your vertical, for your vertical, if it is oil, gas, these could be very specific and generic. You should map those things. For example, here I said modular products, JIT, TQM and so on, and logistics, IT, connectivity and so on. So if you are using oil and gas, then it could be something different. You may need some asset specific requirements and trade policies and resources and management and so on. So basically, it is very important that you map this and find out what are the enablers for this. And then, of course, you can see what is the lead time and so on. What are the enablers to make your lead time low at each point and so on. And cost, quality, flexibility and others. Whatever are the relevant performance measures, and what are the current enablers, if you want to change them, if you can, if it is possible to change them in terms of the delivery mechanisms and choice of partners, choice of suppliers, choice of countries, you should do that. So that, and these enablers become very important. In other words, we are translating whatever the ecosystem, this one what we have, into something very specific to which that will affect your performance of the lead time and cost and so on. So, when you are trying to get your feasible supply chain configuration, then you should first map this and then use that. And what do we have at the end of the supply chain formation phase? So we said there are two steps in supply chain design. The first step is supply chain formation. What is supply chain formation? You collect all the players that you have and their countries, their ecosystems and all that. This is a phase in which you collect all the information and map all the supply chain configurations. You do some kind of a higher level performance measurement, higher level risk assessment and so on. Now, this is a part of the strategic studies that any particular company should be doing. And the ecosystem map, various network partners, including manufacturing, logistics and IT, their countries, regions and locations, that's what we have. Risks that the ecosystem faces, the innovations that are possible to make it big in the industry, the value chain architecture with outsourced or ownership details. So this is a strategic phase with a lot of information collection and it is data dominant. Now, based on this data, you could do a lot of analytics to find out which is the supply chain and so on. So this is basically an important thing when people talk of big data. This is the kind of big data that you need for the supply chain design. So this contains the textual data, it contains the data for the countries, contains opinions of experts and several things. Now, how do you select suppliers using this? You can use analytical hierarchy process, you can use machine learning, this one, and so on. So there are several methods, genetic algorithms to everything that is available or optimization techniques that are available. Now, those techniques are not the ones that are important. All this homework and the collection of data is the one that is important. So that's the first step. So once we have finished the first step, we get into the second step of this one. Before that, there is what is called project planning. Now, it depends that whether you are talking of a greenfield or you are talking of an existing, this one. In other words, what do we mean by greenfield? If you want to invest in a new country, you want to build factories and you want to select suppliers and your selected suppliers also want to build their assets in the particular country, then you are dealing with project management, which involves construction, management of facilities, attracting partners, suppliers, coordinating service providers, goods and information delivery. So this project management is very well studied subject, and there are a lot of this one available for this. But you have to be extremely careful when you have to deal with any land acquisition problems and so on, and also social problems. In other words, people should not protest against your entry into this. And also, you should be able to negotiate with the government, with the social groups and so on. So, the kind of talent that is needed for negotiation is different in this particular case. So, possible cost and time overruns. So, basically, your industrialization and land conversion creates tensions between the government, industry and farmers. Because 51% of land in India is cultivable. So, some small farmers, they basically own the land, and the government has to have laws to take it away from them and give some compensation. So, it requires several approvals and may require dealing with several government departments, and this may result in time and cost overruns. IT logistics infrastructure could be weak, and end-to-end delivery service providers may not be available. In case of electronic and apparel manufacturing, project planning involves partner selection, contract manufacturer from global list, and developing connections. In case of auto, there could be land acquisition requirement and government permissions. Then this step of project planning should be treated carefully. So, basically, that's what it is, and so on. So, importantly, suffice it to say that that at the end of the first stage of project of supply chain formation, you have all the information that you need. Now, you have to build governance mechanisms or frameworks for partner selection, coordination and government. So, this is please remember that what we are doing is a design. Now, design is not to a specific company or this one. It's a generalized design. It's a methodology or a framework that we are trying to develop here. So, this is a framework for partner selection, coordination and control. So, what we did so far is to have a list of players for each of the items that we need for the manufacturing items, like suppliers of a particular component, for services including logistics, audit, finance and so on. So, you have all the players in all the countries where you require. That's you have a list. You have also what are the kinds of innovations that are possible in this. You can outsource, you can do whatever, and also you have all the risks, list of risks that you may face during a short period of time. The risk profile may change of countries and companies and the banks and so on. But as of now, at that time, if you are talking of an ordering at that point in time, then we have those risk profiles. So, governance, partner selection and coordination. A separate chain is formed for each order. How do you do the partner selection? In other words, you have this list, big list that we have. From that, you have to basically select the partners for the particular order. So, how do you want to do it? You want to minimize the lead time? You want to minimize the cost? Or you want to maximize the quality? What is that you want to do? Depending on that, you could do social network analysis, you could do optimization, you could do whatever to select the partners. So, and there is a structural features that you should also remember that your suppliers may have some asset specificity and you may require some special capabilities. So, you should see that your suppliers have those structural features. And similarly, the relational ties. So, your business requires that your suppliers have some ties. It's not just the product you are looking for. You are looking for a social relationship with that country. So, if they have government connections, social organizations, cluster management, education institutions, etc., those ties become important for you. So, does your supplier has the structural features, the knowledge for manufacturing of the product that he is promising, and also the social capital? So, you look for that and then try to select your partner. And once you select the partner, determining who does what and when and communicating to everyone involves supply chain planning and visibility. This is standardized things. Once you know your product, once you have selected suppliers, once your product is standardized, you know the capabilities of all your suppliers, then how do you plan? This is the ERP systems and then supply chain planning systems of I2O, SAP, Oracle and all that. You have the software that is available. And also there is the supply chain visibility that is possible using the sensor network, RFID tags and so on. There is the execution. Now this is an important part that happens. Execution is control tower monitor order status so that processes work as per plan and control exceptional events. Now this is a kind of a new thing, although it exists in several other contexts like power systems, airlines and so on. But for the supply chains, it is a new thing. Now supply chains are used to thinking that you have planned and things will happen as per plan. But they don't happen as per plan. That's because of globalization, the long supply chains, the nature of disruptions which are not mitigated and several other reasons. It's important to have a control tower which monitors the order status and the processes work as per plan. So you have to basically, when you are trying to build the next part of your supply chain design, you have to have tools, optimization tools or whatever. You have to, based on your requirements, you should select your partners for the order on hand. If the order depends on where the client is, you may want to minimize the cost or maximize the quality or whatever. And you also do the supply chain planning coordination, and also you should have some facilities for execution. So let's look at the partner selection. The partner selection, we identify suppliers for various components and services from all over the globe. That's what we have done already. We shortlist them based on the criteria mentioned, such as location, country's policies, delivery costs, asset specificity, risk proneness, innovation capabilities, technology sophistication of hard and soft infrastructure. So we are looking for hard and soft technology sophistication, etc. And optimization, transaction cost analysis, social networks, several other things are used in the pre-selection, new selection process. So what are the mathematical models? The partner selection problem can be formulated using fuzzy AHP or multi-integer programming. And one can rank order the suppliers for each component based on the ecosystem parameters, based on the transaction cost economics. So what is the TCE and partner selection? Transaction costs are the costs incurred to coordinate and connect the links in the global supply chain. What are the transaction costs? They are the costs incurred to coordinate and connect all the links in the global supply chain. They relate to finding a suitable trading partner, negotiating, setting up the contract and monitoring and compliance and so on. The transaction costs include observable costs, which are transport costs, import costs, customs and so on, and soft costs. So basically, if you look at this one, we have already incurred the soft costs in negotiating, in basically getting all the information and so on in this. So what we have basically look at now, since we have already incurred into the soft costs in the supply chain formation stage, what we have to do is to look at the observable costs. And partly, if you, for a specific supplier, once you have selected, if you want more information, then there are the soft costs associated with this. And the hard observable costs decrease with trade liberalization and decreasing transportation costs. The soft costs of social connections gain importance. You know, this is where once the trade liberalization and the WTO come into effect, the transport costs, import duties and so on, they are basically well regulated. But the soft costs, they take gain importance. That's where I think the importance of the the supply chain formation comes into this one. When you are talking of the transaction costs, where the soft costs are observable costs, all the soft costs, most of the soft costs, they go into the supply chain formation stage. And that's where one has to spend time and effort and costs. So once you have done that exercise, then the transaction partner selection becomes easy. As we see here, the transaction costs are given here. They could be asset specific and so on. You can calculate the transaction costs based on the delivery resource institutions and so on. And once you have all these things, then you can select the particular supplier. So, three characteristics of transaction costs affect the asset specificity, uncertainty, and frequency. Now, transaction cost economies theory, when transaction costs are low, use of smart market governance, and transaction costs are high, hierarchy is efficient. In other words, when your transaction costs are high, dealing with somebody in some others, this one, then you better do it yourself. When the transaction costs are low, you outsource it. Now here, what we are trying to do in the supply chain formation stage is to look at all the transaction costs and find out for each supplier, for each component, who are the basically less transaction cost suppliers. That's what the supply chain formation stage looks at, which looks at not only the cost, innovations, risks, and so on. And based on all this, you try to select, rank order the suppliers. So, supposing you look at if you do it yourself, how much it is. And if the lowest transaction costs of the lowest of the low rank order, high rank order one, are higher than yours, then you better do it yourself. So, basically it depends on the governance, when you want to do outsource or you want to do it yourself. In between market and hierarchy, there is the hybrid, this one. So, asset specificity, supply chain specific assets, good relationships between members of network and cluster, assets such as specific dyes and so on. Resources. Now, this is a slide we are now trying to look at. What are all the asset specific ecosystem? In other words, the asset specificity is not just for the supply chain. It can come to the resources. In other words, the human clusters, financial institutions, etc., and the ports, airports, location specific assets. These become important depending on your vertical. Supposing you are doing oil, this one, to import oil when the ship containing the oil comes, and they should have specialized equipment and a refinery nearby, and so on. So basically, the port where it goes, it becomes asset specific. And also in some of these R&D and so on, you may require human expertise, particularly in biotech, you may require PhDs. If you are in IT, then you may require well-trained programmers and so on. So it depends, the resources could be also asset specific. Institutions, for example, some of the governments create benefits to companies in taxes and tariffs. For example, special economic zones, special universities for training manpower and so on. You know, India has a lot of triple ITs for information technology degrees and so on. So, here, when you are selecting a particular supplier in a country, you should also look at what are the special economic zones there. You save on them. If you can either do FDI there, foreign direct investment, or you can outsource to a partner in the special economic zone who can export to you. So, they are basically, that's dependent on that. And delivery infrastructure, ports, airports, railroads, highways, and special trucks for carrying finished vehicles, and heavy power plant equipment such as boilers, temperature controlled warehouses, refrigerated vehicles, forklift trucks, guidance systems. So, these are all become highly asset specific. and for example, container freight stations, and also, you know, container handling, and having trucks to carry containers from the port into the city and so on. Some of these costs are not flexible or transferable across products or organizations. Infrastructure created, manpower trained, costs of attracting 3PLs, software providers, these are not flexible. You cannot transfer to somebody else. So what happens is, with the asset specificity of this, you are stuck with that particular product and so on. So the supplier is creating all these facilities, have to create all these facilities for you. So he may demand a contract saying that, look, I have created all this for you, so you should probably stay with me and have a long-term contract, or to have some other way of trying to make up for the money that is spent on the asset specific system. So there is what is called frequency and uncertainty. The frequency of interactions between the buyer and supplier is important because that will create the economies of scale. If it is a one-time transaction for 1 year, then it may not be worth the while. To recover costs of specialized mechanisms created and established relations with partner networks, you spend a lot of money and effort at this. This is where, if you compare a trader with a particular manufacturer who is trying to build up relations. If you are a manufacturer, you are doing it for your own sake, and your orders will be maybe 3 times, 4 times a season, a year, once every season. But on the other hand, if it is a trader, he does for several people and several countries. So that's where he can get more frequency. And environmental uncertainty can come from suppliers, customers, competitors, regulatory agencies, and financial markets, etc. Mode of governments used to coordinate partners depends on sources of uncertainty. So if you have high uncertainty, then you better do it yourself. In other words, if going to any other country, it creates a lot of uncertainty. For example, in R&D, everybody does it themselves. That's because once you get out of this country, then out of your hands, you may lose whatever you have, the intellectual property and so on. So basically, it all depends on what the uncertainty interactions and so on. So what we have next is the coordination, that is the partner selection. Now, why is the partner selection important? You have a list of all the players in the global supply chain, and during the partner selection, you use either analytical techniques or heuristics or previous experience or data analytics to find out for that particular order who are the suppliers. And this depends on your asset specificity and so on. You can find out use transaction cost analysis to find out what is the total cost, and you can minimize, select the supplier from that. And you can also minimize the risk, take the risk and other things into account. The second, under the governance is the coordination. Coordination is basically supply chain planning. It is, you have, for your order, you have selected all the suppliers, all the logistics providers, manufacturers, and so on. So you have the path for your supply chain. Now, for that path, you have to basically tell people, communicate with all the partners, tell them what they should do, which are the product they are building, what are the specifications, and what are the timelines, who should do what and when. So that's coordination. The coordination includes software-based method for it. It determines who does what and when, communicating to everyone. For every order, selecting the suppliers, assigning functions to them, such as what to supply, how is it to be produced. For example, product tolerances and process standards, and the production and delivery schedules, given the product specification, and communicating it to the chain partners. So this is typical supply chain planning issue. So, you, while doing this, you may take into account the capacities of your suppliers, because if you require more capacity, then basically you may have to go to two suppliers and so on. So, basically the kind of contracts you have, everything matters here in terms of coordination. Then, of course, this is a standard supply chain. You have software from Oracle, software from ERP and others, and there is a lot of supply chain visibility that is, and there are any number of methods including internet, email, and to communicate with the partners and so on. Well, the next one is building the control tower. Now, this is the otherwise called the execution. Now, we have dealt with the partner selection, where you are using all the optimization algorithms and so on to select the partners to minimize the cost or minimize the lead time and so on. You have all the information from the previous step of global supply chain formation, and you can use the information about the transaction cost economics and all that to do this. And the second step is coordination. Once you have accepted the order, you have selected the suppliers. Now, based on the information you have, you can use supply chain planning techniques to do who does what and when. Now, the issue, please remember, is you may get several orders for this. It's not a one time this one. Having done all the exercise on the global supply chain formation, you may get two orders, three orders a day, and each order takes a different supply chain route. And for each of those orders, you have to do the coordination. Tell which are the suppliers. It can be made some suppliers. In other words, in the morning you may get an order for 100,000 skirts, and you may go through a route like cotton from Bangladesh and so on, and finally it is ironed in Mexico and then sent to United States. And in the afternoon you may get another order from Reebok, and that order may go through some other route for the same things. So, the orders differ, and it depends on the capacity at that time, and also the value. The sweater from Walmart, they may require $10. And the same sweater from Macy's, it may be $100. So, the quality of the sweater should depend, because when somebody is paying, they don't pay for the same price. So, now, once all this is done, you have planned for it, and your process is in order, and everything is assigned, and people are doing it. How do you model, monitor, and control whatever is happening? If everything happens as per plan, then you don't require the control tower, but it doesn't happen. So, there is a need for this. So, design of control tower. What is a control tower? It basically has the information regarding your process. What is happening where? You have that information, and you have to collect the data of what is happening. All the dates, the quantities, and the quality, and so on. And then see whether everything is happening as per schedules. So, you know, cloud computing, big data analytics are fundamental to this step. Now, supposing you have all these partners in various countries. They collect all the data. You know, I have collected an order of 10,000, this one. I have done the dyeing of these items, and then I have supplied. And this data is stored where? That these are all small players. So, you have to collect the data. Maybe it is on a cloud. Maybe it is not. Maybe you have to collect from their information, the Microsoft spreadsheets and so on. And have all this on a cloud. Let's assume that you have cloud and all the suppliers place this one in the cloud. And you have to use the big data analytics to basically find out whether anything is going wrong, or is it everything is according to order. You see, this is not human thing anymore. Because with the suppliers, if you are a big trader, then, you know, you have several manufacturers dealing with 4,000 odd suppliers in all over the world. To have a human decision making to find out whether anything is going wrong or the alerts becomes difficult. So you have to have basically somebody telling you whether a BPO kind of thing, which where exception management is done. In other words, whenever there is an exception, somebody reports that to you and you give the solution based on expert advice. That's one way of doing it. Another way is you take the data and then use expert system, decision support systems, case-based reasoning, hybrid control systems, etc. for exception management and so on. So the point is, if everything is going as per plan, then there's nothing to be done. You just collect the information and give the status normal. But on the other hand, if there is an exception, supposing the quality of a particular supplier is bad, then you have to basically expedite that, either that fellow does, the supplier does it again, or you have to assign it to some other supplier, you have to do some expediting and so on. So basically, depending on the schedules, the time you have to basically decide what to do with this. So that's the kind of decision making that the control towers come. But currently, the control towers exist in airlines, power networks, rail networks, etc. But there is the control towers for transportation networks is being talked about. For global transportation, control towers is being talked about. But not much in operation, but the entire supply chain control tower is still an hypothetical, this one, although people are doing it in some pieces. There are several applications such as 4PLs, monitoring and execution using BPOs. For example, Penske Logistics does this control tower execution using the BPO Genpac in India. So, for example, what Penske does is supplies, it transports the auto components from various suppliers in the United States to Detroit for all the big three companies. Now, Penske, what it does, it does the execution. It tells which truck to pick up where and who is the driver, and if something happens at this, the driver just calls a 800 number, and the BPO staff fixes that, sometimes consulting the original or by their hindsight or their experience, they may do it all by themselves. So the point here is all the trucks, the drivers, they're through GPS and through driver's cell phones, they are all being monitored remotely. This happens. The truck transportation happens in the United States, but the monitoring is all done by a call center within India. There, when you have the call center, there is human expertise that is there and trained people, then there may not be so much of automation that is needed. But still, if you want to use this, store this data and learn from the experiences and use some machine learning techniques for future use, then it's necessary to design the control tower properly. So this is being talked about, but not much design of this one. And of course, the execution in terms of 4PLs provide end-to-end B2B logistics services. This is fourth-party logistics services. They coordinate all services needed for goods transfer, warehousing, a shipper and distribution ends. In other words, and arrange for trucks all through the journey. You know, if I'm a 4PL, which I'm acting on behalf of some client shipper, then the shipper has no role in choice of the trucks. I choose the trucks and manages customs clearance at ports and airports. It manages loading, unloading, cross-docking, emergent transit as required. and manage all exceptions through the control room. Truck failure, truck registration, payments and customs, driver schedules, expediting if it is needed, and so on. So, if you are talking of these kind of functions, then you can see the functions and importance of the control room here. So, this is the diagram which finally what we have here is this is the suppliers which are selected in the group formation stage, and logistics providers, manufacturers, and so on. So, all the providers in all the countries. And for a particular order, I use the partner selection where I use the algorithms that we have. And the coordination is I tell who does what to all these people for that particular order, or if there are several orders to several orders to several people. And finally, I use the control tower for execution. So, this is summarizes, this diagram summarizes the governance, which is partner selection, coordination, and execution here. So, the supply chain design has basically two parts. The first one is the supply chain formation, which includes the five steps that we have. Mapping the ecosystem to finding the final configuration. And the second step is the design of the governance, and which includes partner selection, coordination, and execution, design of the algorithms, and so on. So, this basically gives you an integrated supply chain design procedure, which is valid for not only global supply chains, but local supply chains as well. But does where this kind of thing exist anywhere? The answer is no. Now, so basically that's about the global supply chain design. But what is the kind of talent that you require here? Now, you are having two steps. The first step is global supply chain formation. The second step is the partner selection monitoring. The coordination, monitoring, and control, and so on. So, but the talent for the talent, soft skills, R&D, execution abilities, connections, domain knowledge needed for each step in the supply chain design is difficult. The talent needed for the group working on supply chain formation is more knowledge and data intensive and requires domain industry knowledge, political and economic factors of the countries and regions, strategy formation, innovation and risk evaluation, and finally use of analytical techniques for location selection and group formation. So, it is not just running the software. It is not running supply chain software. What it involves is much different. And project management requires skills to interact and manage with the government, local communities. Local connections and knowledge will help get approvals quickly and resolve any dispute that may arise with landowners, local communities, and labor unions. And the talent that is needed for coordination execution could be routine during the normal times and can be assisted with tools such as scheduling packages, geographical information systems, and call centers. Now, when I say routine, it's not that it is easy, but it is normally done in the supply chain management, this one, like using these kind of packages and others. So, people use the packages like ERP and others, and also there are some supply chain visibility packages and several other things which are available, which can be used for coordination and execution. But what is difficult is the previous stage, which is basically it requires. Now, in earlier days, it was not very important because you have strong or dense ties with your suppliers. So, they are usually local, you know them, you invest in them, and so on. So, you need not have to worry much about that. But if you are going global, And if the markets are becoming volatile, and if the countries and governments are changing their strategies every day, then the supply chain formation becomes a very important step. In emergency situations such as natural disasters, terrorist attacks, or long-drawn labor disputes, risk management teams assisted with decent support systems should come on board to resolve the crisis. Of course, that's what the execution is about. So, to say, as people say, jatasya maranam dhruvam, same is applicable for companies and strategies. What it means is basically any human being, basically which is born, is destined to die. The same is true for companies and strategies. No company, no design, product, process, network, ecosystem is permanent. The ecosystems change based on the resource availability, based on the technologies available, based on the government, the elected and so on. All of them keep evolving, and your designs, products, processes, networks, ecosystems must evolve suitably to keep the global competitiveness. So there is no shortcut here. So what are the conclusions that we have? Dispersed supply chain design involves formation and governance. There are two steps here. And formation is a very important step which is often ignored and creates operational problems to severe dispersions later. If you are not careful with the formation, then you ignore the risks, you ignore the government policies, you ignore the financial status of your suppliers and so on, then you could get into problems later. Capabilities for the formation stage are much different from governance and may require relationships with government, trade, social groups, labor, resource owners, and B2B and B2C delivery service providers. So the social capital for the company is much more in the supply chain formation stage than in the execution and coordination stage. Execution is typically professional, whereas the supply chain formation is typically social. Implementation of the governance needs sensor networks or big data management and cloud. You know, implementation of the governance needs sensor networks, big data management, and cloud computing. Now, what are the kinds of decisions you are going to make? Well, we know in the supply chain case, the decisions that we need to make. And what then, that depends on that decides the data you need to collect. And once you collected the data, then you can use it for your decision making. So the cloud computing basically stores all your data and it has all your algorithms and can be used with advantage for small and medium enterprises, hospitals, cities and villages. I mean, whatever we have said here is basically for supply chain networks. But what is a hospital? I mean, hospitals and their sourcing and other things, patients, you can represent them as a service network, draw their ecosystem, and then represent how to design a service system for that. So theory development needs integration of social networks, machine learning, optimization, game theory with supply chain networks. So suffice it to say that we have dealt with in this two lectures that the design of global supply chain networks, and two important steps in this. The first step is the global supply chain formation, which requires a lot of data collection and analysis. And the second one is running your factory, and which requires partner selection for your order, and then coordination. And then finally execution. The execution is a step which is ignored in most of the supply chains today, but It is a step that is very important here. So, but we can see the importance of this, why we are seeing a turnaround. So, for example, manufacturing is returning to US. Basis for global manufacturing footprint, total costs of making products, worker productivity, labor, logistics, share of total costs, hidden costs and risks. So, the low cost advantage of China disappears with changed cost structure between China and the US. So, we are seeing now, in other words, earlier there is a low cost country advantage. But now, today, we see manufacturing is returning to US. So, you can see the importance of the global supply chain formation that we are talking about. As things change, how then for certain products, you can see here for certain products which are low end, then still your food, beverages and paper and wood products and so on, they are local, whereas some of them are basically outsourceable and so on. So, basically you can see that depending on the logistics costs as well as the labor costs, you see that the outsourcing phenomenon is changing a lot. So, the future of global supply chains, what is it? An increase in the objective and subjective transaction costs. From higher oil prices to buy local campaigns and murky protectionism, government procurement in favor of local firms indicates that in the future supply chains will probably be smaller and more regional. Several companies such as Boeing are restructuring their supply chains. So, I mean, these two slides show you the importance of supply chain design, frequent supply chain redesign. It's not as though you can design your supply chain and sit back and relax for years. Thank you.